Thanks very much, and it's a great pleasure to be here in Cologne to talk to you about quality specifications. And I come from Dundee in Scotland, which is Scotland's fourth city. You can see a picture of our beautiful setting by the River Tay at the bottom right. And I've been a clinical biochemist for well over 40 years, nearly 30 of them in Dundee in Ninewells Hospital Medical School at the top left, and lately commissioning the Scottish Bowel Screening Laboratory, which is also in Dundee, shown in the top right. And some of you would probably like to join me in the bottom left, and especially on a nice day like this, but it's really great to be here, and I don't mind giving up a few days sailing to be with you here today. Quality specifications is the remit of Carmen Perique and myself, and you'll note that in the programme there are two questions to cover this session. And the first is, can we encourage labs to predefine quality goals? And that's actually an easy question to answer. Predefine means defined before, of course, and there is no doubt that there's only one answer to this question. Laboratories must define quality goals a priori, since these are necessary prerequisites for undertaking quality planning to decide the number of controls and the rules. And ISO 15189 states quite clearly, the laboratory shall design internal quality control systems that verify the attainment of the intended quality. So you have to define quality a priori. The second question is rather more difficult. Is there a compromise position regarding the use of biological variation, total error, and uncertainty of measurement or measurement uncertainty? And this is a difficult question because does a conflict really exist that requires a compromise? And I personally think there isn't a conflict, that total error and measurement uncertainty are rather different conceptually, and biological variation data are applicable to both. Now, setting quality specifications in the laboratory is difficult. There's no doubt about that, especially since there are many published recommendations. Further new recommendations keep being published. Test results are used in many different settings. It is said that neither patients nor clinicians are harmed by our current performance. And I must say the manufacturers also don't seem to use anything but the state of the art for use in either development or marketing, and use phrases such as good as, better than, and so on, looking at what is attainable or what has been attained. Because of these difficulties, some years ago now, my friend Per Peterson, who unfortunately can't be with us today because he's undergoing fairly major surgery this Friday, he and I sat down and tried to put some order into the chaos, which resulted in the publication of an editorial in Clinical Chemistry, which suggested the idea of putting strategies to set quality specifications into a hierarchy. And as you will all know, in Stockholm, there was a consensus conference the year after, sponsored by IFCC, IUPAC, and the World Health Organization, which looked at the concepts and set the Stockholm hierarchy into place, where strategies to set analytical quality specifications were placed in order of goodness. So at the top, assessment of the effect of analysis on specific clinical decision-making, specific clinical settings, is the ultimate. But that's difficult, and so assessment of the effect of analysis on general clinical decision-making, i.e. using biological variation, is the second in the hierarchy, and as we've just seen, is very popular. Clinicians' views on changes also makes use of biological variation data, but it's only been done in a few interesting areas, particularly by Sverri Sandberg and his colleagues. Third in the hierarchy are professional recommendations, guidelines from usually professional bodies, and very often they are now biological variation based. Further down in the hierarchy are quality specifications laid down by proficiency testing or EQS organisers, and again these are more and more over time becoming biological variation based, And finally, we have, if there's nothing else, published data on the state of the art. Now, no one thinks that the hierarchy is perfect, and it certainly shouldn't be seen as monolithic set in stone. There is, throughout the hierarchy, an inconsistency in approach. Some of the strategies give goals for imprecision, some give goals for bias, some for total error. But so far, none are for measurement uncertainty. Moreover, between subject biological variation is used in many of the current methods for determining analytical quality specifications for allowable bias. However, you can vary for many quantities between subject biological variation by partitioning the population according to, for example, gender or age. So you can make between subject biological variation of different magnitudes depending on how you treat the population. However, within subject biological variation is much more constant, both theoretically and in reality. Another problem is that analytical quality specifications differ markedly with the strategy used for derivation. And even when the strategy is at the same level in the hierarchy, you can get quite different analytical quality specifications depending upon how you use the strategy. And very, very importantly, strategies for calculation of combinations of imprecision and bias, i.e. total error, vary significantly. Just an example of some of the problems are problems with using EQAS or PT allowable limits. And here, there are for four quantities widely done in laboratory medicine. These are the allowable limits from the US, from the CLIA, based upon biological variation, the Australian Royal College of Pathologists of Australasia, in Germany, the Rilleback, and from the Czech Republic. And you can see that these are very, very different. And it is really quite difficult to understand why different EQA schemes have apparently very, very different levels of acceptability. And as we will discuss this afternoon, perhaps harmonization is needed and is achievable. The traditional approach, of course, is that often attributed to Jim Westgaard, where he has imprecision, which is random error, and we estimate that, as you know, from internal quality control. Inaccuracy or bias, systematic error, estimate from method comparison studies or external quality assessment schemes or proficiency testing. So total error represents the overall or total error that may occur in a test result both due to imprecision and bias, random and systematic errors. And total error is usually created as the modulus of bias, that's bias ignoring the sign, plus the standard deviation multiplied by a coverage factor depending on the probability. So this, according to some, is a linear sum, and to others, it would be seen as adding an apple and a pear, or an apple and an orange. It's a very common strategy to use this sort of formula to set total allowable error. So the total allowable error, based upon biological variation, is less than a quarter times the group biological variation, that's within and between subject, that is the desirable or allowable error for bias, plus 1.65, which is to give 95% probability, times one half of the within subject biological variation, which is the desirable goal for imprecision. Now, we all know that if we use this formula, some of the quality specifications generated are very, very difficult to obtain with current technology and methodology, for example, for sodium, chloride, and calcium. And should we stop doing these tests because they don't meet analytical quality specifications based upon biological variation? No, because we do get clinically useful data. Some quality specifications, for example, for triglycerides or enzyme activities, are very easy to achieve. So should we let the quality slip? And again, the answer is no, since there are many, many advantages to having error which is lower or uncertainty, which is lower than that set by the analytical quality specifications. And of course, we can have multi-levels, and there's a multi-level model which uses different multipliers, optimum, desirable, minimum, and at our 2011 convention, as you'll see in the preprint, which is in your packs, we suggested that there might be an ideal, a fourth level of analytical quality specifications based upon biology. So let's now turn to the more interesting, perhaps, uncertainty of measurement. And we have already seen, it's quite clearly stated in ISO 15189, the laboratory shall determine the uncertainty of results where relevant and possible. And you've already seen the definitions for uncertainty, a parameter associated with the results of measurement, which characterizes the dispersion of values that can be reasonably attributed to the measurand. And clearly the intent of ISO is to make measurements transferable or comparable over time and geography. And this requires elimination or correcting biases. And as we've already nicely seen this morning, adding together the uncertainties as variances. Our remit was total error versus measurement uncertainty. But I think that rather than defining an allowable total error with estimated elements of all types of random and systematic error, in my opinion, where possible, all results should be corrected for known biases and should have an estimate of measurement uncertainty attached. And if you want a really good, easy guide to measurement uncertainty, I highly recommend this article on Jim Westgar's website done by Graham White from Flinders Medical Centre in Adelaide, who I work with in Aberdeen and Australia, and has done a tremendous amount to try and translate the real difficulties of uncertainty of measurement into practical information and practical tools for us, the practicing laboratorian. So Graham said I could show his summary of his article. So remember, total error provides an approximate worst case value for the error of a measuring system, a worst case value. Total error does not recognize that each individual patient's result could have possible outcomes with less error than bias plus Z times the standard deviation. Total error is useful for setting upper limits of allowable error, but measurement uncertainty is not concerned with estimating the total error of a measuring system. Measurement uncertainty, as we've already seen, is concerned with estimating an interval of values within which the true value of a measured analyte or measurand is believed to lie with a stated level of confidence. And again, we'll have to state very categorically that known bias, if we measure the bias, why incorporate it into total error? Why not get rid of it? So eliminate or minimize bias. Measurement uncertainty, as you've seen, consists of a single measurement result. It's the best estimate of the true value and centers on it the dispersion of results. So we're here to talk about analytical quality specifications. So what's the strategy for measurement uncertainty? Well, as we've kept saying, bias should be minimized, so the analytical quality specification for bias can only be zero. And that's certainly not a new idea. And I found way back when, in the dim history of my life, that I'd actually written down the ultimate analytical goal for inaccuracy is that there should be no bias. And that was quite a long time ago, as you'll see. There are also good reasons for making measurement uncertainty as small as possible to make the dispersion of each test result small, which allows population reference intervals to be narrower, makes reference change values, as we've seen from Graham, smaller, makes changes seen in serial results of higher significance, it minimizes result misclassification when we're using decision limits, and so on and so forth. Make measurement uncertainty small. How small? Well, the optimum analytical quality specification for random variation is, as we've seen before, first talk this morning, less than a quarter of the within subject biological variation. And this means that the total variation will not be confounded very much by test result variability, only about 3%. And as you've seen, there are other ways that you can do it. However, you can't really forget about bias, although it'd be nice to do so. And I've always thought that we could divide bias into two: systematic bias, which is methodological bias, which should be minimized, got rid of by a variety of strategies, and random bias, which is the bias that does occur as we go on when we have changes in lots of calibrator and reagents and so on and so forth. However, the estimates of random bias are, of course, included in the longer-term analysis of imprecision, which is what you should use to determine the measurement uncertainty in your laboratories in the model, according to Graham, White and others. So finally, let's think again about how could we define, using biological variation, what else, a quality specification for total measurement uncertainty. As we've seen, the simplest optimum quality specification for inherent random variation is less than a quarter of the biological variation. The analytical quality specifications for changes in random bias is less than a third of the biological variation, as you can read about in the preprint. So therefore, when you add these two variances together, the total allowable measurement uncertainty is, and here's something new for you, have a think about this. So our new quality specification is measurement uncertainty should be less than 0.4 times the within subject biological variation. Thanks very much.